Hello everyone, this is Tae Kwon from Keene, New Hampshire, and this is your RIPE Global Implantology Case Review. I would like to review a case of Joni today. She presented to my office with failing endodontic treatment on maxillary left central incisor and lateral incisor, which are part of four-unit bridge from maxillary right lateral incisor to maxillary left lateral incisor. As you can see, the maxillary right lateral incisor is a cantilever restoration, and she had trauma in the past, which ultimately led to failure of the endodontic therapy. When you look at periapical radiographs, you can clearly see there is a large periapical lesion on left lateral incisors, and you do not really see too much going on, any lesion on the right central incisor. Although initially the patient was recommended for implant therapy to replace left incisors only with two implants, when I look at Joni's case, I was thinking, wait a minute, with the same number of implants, which are two, we could place one on the right incisor area, lateral incisor area, and then left incisor area, and then make it into four-unit bridge instead of doing a patchwork. So this is where a comprehensive treatment plan is extremely important, as opposed to doing a patchwork. Sometimes when you do a patchwork, it might be a little bit easier, but at the end, it can lead to over-treatment, but also the patient become victim of the patchwork. So this is where looking at a case more comprehensively and then provide a treatment that is gonna last much longer become critical for your success. So we proceed with the extraction. We remove tooth number, central incisor, and left lateral incisor atraumatically. You can clearly see extraction was done with a very minimal trauma to the bone. However, if you remember from radiograph, there was a large periapical lesion. So how do I remove the periapical lesion? I don't trust myself using a curette into these sockets, hoping to clear all this infection. What I do is I elevated a large flap so that I can visualize the defect completely. And then you can clearly see on this area, there's a large periapical lesion. Could we remove these lesions without elevating the flap? Probably not. Another way to do it is you can extract these teeth and then let them heal first and then go back to do the bone graft, which I don't like, because then you ended up doing another surgical procedure. After I clear these periapical lesions onto this alveolar bone defect, I graft it with freeze-dried bone allograft. These bones were hydrated with platelet-derived growth factor to maximize potential of periodontal and guided bone regeneration. And then after that, I placed cross-linked collagen membrane, which are completely tacked using periosteal sutures. And after that, I coronally advanced the flap to achieve primary closure over the defect. Now, I have to wait for this osseous healing for about minimum 6 to 8 months. So at 8 months follow-up, this is how Joni presented. You can see the soft tissue healing looks really nice. You can appreciate convexity on the maxillary incisor area. This is the occlusal view. And now I'm going to make an incision. And you can clearly see wonderful outcome of bone regeneration was noted on the area. And based on the surgical guide, I placed two implants on the lateral incisor areas. And this is the occlusal view. Don't forget, as I previously mentioned, you always want to leave at least 2 millimeters of bone buckled to the fixture, all right? So the implant needs to go as palatal as you can. Because when you have less than 2 millimeters of buckled bone buckled to the fixture, then the implants are going to experience the risk of recession. And after placing the implants, this is how we look on another view without the mount fixture. And primary closure was achieved over the implants. and implants will be further submerged for osseous healing. And roughly 3-4 months later, we're going to expose this implant with possible connective tissue graft, and then patient will be cleared for either temporary restoration if patient wants to develop some soft tissue aesthetics, or final restoration directly. So the key for this case is to understand when you want to separate doing minimally invasive extraction and bone graft from elevating a large flap. Two, another thing that I want to review on this case is that how long we have waited. I waited almost 6 to 8 months because it's a large augmentation procedure. Three, a predictable bone augmentation can be achieved, A, if you give enough time, but two, if the right material is used in a right way, especially how I fix the membrane completely so that the membrane and bone graft are completely immobilized. And then two, I use the right growth factor to induce better outcome of regeneration. Three, I achieve tension-free primary closure, making sure that the bone graft and membrane that I place are not going to be exposed or minimally exposed during the healing process. If you achieve that, placement of the implant that surgical day will be the easiest day that you're going to have for that patient because solid foundation has been already established. If you want to learn a little bit more about how to do the bone graft better predictably, then I'll be more than happy to share that in RIPE Global Fellowship in Modern Implantology. I look forward to seeing you again, and I'll see you for your next case review.